events that shaped our lives. Join Hal Fishman and Stan Chambers for a KTLA News special, Whatever Happened To, tonight at 10 on the WB5.
Good evening. I'm Sam Rubin, here to celebrate KTLA's 50 golden years of broadcasting from the very first television station west of the Mississippi. Tonight, you'll relive treasured memories of Channel 5, and I'll be with you throughout the evening to help you celebrate with us. So get out the popcorn and get ready for a trip through time. In a few moments, you'll see our very first sign-on. KTLA's 50 golden years is next.
This is KTLA Television, Los Angeles. Owned and operated by Television Productions Incorporated, a service of Paramount Pictures, with studios adjoining the Paramount lot in Hollywood, transmitting from atop Mount Wilson, California, on television channel number 5, a frequency of 76 to 82 megacycles. Again tonight, we're ready to bring you a full evening of television entertainment. From now until 7 o'clock, watch the news go by, and listen to recorded music as you align your receivers for best reception of KTLA.
Hello, I'm Stan Chambers, and if I can just get this thing aligned to 76 megacycles, we'll be ready to bring you
KTLA's 50 Golden Years, a celebration of the first TV station in the West. From our studios in Hollywood, transmitting from atop Mount Wilson, join us for a half century of Los Angeles television memories. You'll see again, or maybe for the first time, Time for Beanie, Lawrence Welk, Corla Pandit, Hopalong Cassidy, Frosty Frolics, Ozzie and Harriet, David Letterman, Bill Stout, Cleek Roberts, Bowling for Dollars, Soupy Sales, Ina Ray Hutton, Dixie Showboat, Roller Derby, and much, much more. How it was on Channel 5 during the past 50 golden years.
I feel pretty fortunate to have been part of KTLA from just about its very beginning. But so much has happened since that January night in 1947 when we first signed on the air that it seems like we're living in a different world. But one of the threads that links that half-century-old world with our world today is this little box, television. Television has not only recorded the changes in our lives and lifestyles over the years, but it's often led the way in causing those changes. And by looking back at some of the shows on KTLA during that time, we can see how TV has changed the world and how the world has changed us. Of course, there weren't very many of us that could be changed. When KTLA first signed on January 22nd, 1947, there were only about 350 TVs in Los Angeles. And those that were properly aligned could see and hear Bob Hope introduce TV to the West, even if you didn't get the call letters quite right.
But I want to tell you, it's a great thrill to be here on this wonderful initial program of station KTL. And ladies and gentlemen,
and from that day on, from that show to these days, not one day has gone by in the past 50 years without KTLA beaming its pictures into the homes across Southern California. At first, our plan tonight was to tell you about all these KTLA moments. Well, we'll still do that. But we've also asked you to tell us about your own favorite KTLA memories. And who better to start than Constance Craig? Constance Craig and KTLA have something very special in common. We were both born on January 22nd, 1947, and we grew up together in Los Angeles. And so this is a very exceptional birthday for both of us.
This is very nice. I thought maybe I'd get some punch and cake, but I didn't know I'd be on television. That was me, my sister Suzanne, and our next door neighbor Charlotte. We lived over on Menlo Avenue, and in those days, we had to go next door to watch television. They'd pop popcorn for us, we'd get dressed up, we'd sit on the floor, and once a week we could see Hopalong Cassidy.
Constance and her friends were not alone in getting hooked on Hoppy. A fellow named Klaus Landsberg, we'll hear more about him later, was almost single-handedly responsible for getting KTLA ready for the air in the 1940s. And in addition to being a technical wizard far ahead of his time, Klaus also had an uncanny knack for deciding what kind of programming would become popular.
So when he came upon some old movies featuring actor Bill Boyd playing Hopalong Cassidy, Klaus thought they might make for good TV shows. Good was an understatement. Before long, the shows became so popular that Boyd decided to make new programs just for TV, and Hopalong Cassidy became the biggest hit in early television. Boyd's widow, Grace, recalled those days for us.
We had stopped at one of those nut burger places, and right next to us was a cameraman that had been worked on some of the Hoppies. And Hoppy looked over at him and he said, "Hey, Bud," he said, can you run films on TV? Because everything was live. And the cameraman thought a minute and he said, yeah, you can run the film. Well, that was it. It literally put KTLA on the map.
Despite the early success of shows like Hoppy, the jury was still out on whether it was really worthwhile to buy a TV set. After all, you could always just watch the action for free in a store window. Several KTLA viewers told us their memories of those days.
I remember going down to the drugstore or a department store and watching the shows. I was amazed.
We see the Indian head, and the Indian head just stares back at us. We wait all afternoon for the Indian head to move. That was called a test pattern in those days.
But people were also beginning to realize that it was much more comfortable to watch at home or at the home of some big spending neighbor.
And when we got our television set, it was interesting. The neighbors did come over, and relatives always wanted to come over, especially if they didn't have a television set. And generally, it increased the social activities in the neighborhood.
So television in general, and KTLA in particular, was already beginning to change our lives, and maybe even for the better. And it was being done with not much more than a cowboy and an Indian, Hopalong Cassidy and a test pattern. Although we're here to celebrate KTLA's golden anniversary, its roots go back even further. As early as 1941, before the U.S. was even in World War II, Paramount Pictures decided it wanted to have a television presence in Los Angeles, and they hired a 25-year-old boy genius named Klaus Landsberg to do the job. In his native Germany, Klaus helped provide television pictures for the 1936 Berlin Olympics, and then fled to the U.S. just one step ahead of the Nazis, who wanted to make use of his technical talents for themselves. In New York, Klaus worked with NBC on the first American demonstration of television for the 1939 World's Fair. And then, lured west by Paramount, young Landsberg came to L.A. alone, carrying two suitcases filled with electronic bits and pieces. A year later, the station was on the air. It was given an experimental license and called W6XYZ. Landsberg was well aware that the most compelling thing about television was its ability to show live pictures. And by September of 1942, he was ready to make his first attempt at what he called a live remote. Taking his cameras to the Paramount soundstage where the movie This Gun for Hire was being filmed with Alan Ladd and Veronica Lake, Klaus gave his viewers a rare behind-the-scenes glimpse of Hollywood at work. Those viewers, by the way, numbered an estimated 100 people. With America at war, the development of television would just come to a standstill. Just weeks after the war's end in 1945, however, Landsberg was producing a very special live remote. A look at the first civilian car to be made since the war began, the 1946 Super Deluxe Ford. Hundreds of people came to see the car, which featured a 100 horsepower engine and such advanced features as a newly designed radiator cap, but they became so intrigued with the TV setup that they turned their attention from the Ford to Klaus and his W6XYZ cameras. Another event that's become a television standard, the Rose Parade, was also first televised by W6XYZ. It was January 1st, 1947, the official transition of experimental station W6XYZ to commercial station KTLA was now just days away. On January 22nd, the day arrived. Many years later, Bob Hope would share with us his feelings about the first KTLA show from the Paramount lot in Hollywood.
Hey, isn't television wonderful? Now you can swap the lights out in the living room without getting your old man suspicious. Well, you just heard a 40-year-old joke, one that I called at the time the first commercially televised egg ever laid on the Western Slope. And the hen house where that egg was laid is right here, a small test stage here at Paramount, where I hosted the first commercial TV program in the West. There's no plaque in this building to mark what an historical site it is, but history was made right here, all right. I wasn't even particularly sure what television was at the time, but I was working here on the Paramount lot. And since Paramount owned KTLA at the time, they asked me if I could run over here and give it a try. I said, okay, and I haven't stopped trying yet, no matter what they say. That opening KTLA program was quite a show. My old pal Jerry Colonna joined me on the show, and so did the DeCastro sisters, who sang Babaloo. And a group called the Rhythmaires sang a little ditty encouraging folks to visit that wonderful town called Managua, Nicaragua, even if you weren't in the CIA.
Managua, Nicaragua is a beautiful town. You buy a hacienda for a few pesos down.
But it really was quite a show. And we went back into our black and white time capsule to let you take a look for yourself. Film of the actual program no longer exists, but here's how the Paramount Newsreel covered it.
I had a little trouble getting here. Madman Munch chased me for three blocks, ladies and gentlemen. But I want to tell you, it's a great thrill to be here on this wonderful initial program of station KTL. And ladies and gentlemen, this is Bob, first commercial television broadcast hope, telling you gals who've tuned in, and I want to make this emphatic, if my face isn't handsome and debonair, please blame it on the static. Which one do I look at? All I want to know is which one picks up the smell. Is this one there? But ladies and gentlemen, here I am televising for Lincoln Automobiles. And it's, I want to tell you right now that it's really a little different from radio, because just last year I did a broadcast for Elgin, and they sent me a watch. And then just a couple of weeks ago, I did a broadcast on the Silver Theater, and they gave me a set of silver. And here I am on tonight for Lincoln. And this is what they gave me. And I have to give 10% to my agent. I don't know how we're going to work that out, but I think it'll work out. But I do want to tell you that it's a thrill being here, because television, I understand, is a combination of radio and pictures. This is a little medium that Crosby invented so he can steal the money without even leaving the house.
Bob Hope was right. With 2020 hindsight, this was a pretty historic moment. But at the time, well, the trade papers like Variety and The Hollywood Reporter barely mentioned the broadcast. No matter, Klaus Landsberg's dream had become a reality. Other TV stations were also trying to get on the air those days, but Klaus was so far ahead, it would be well over a year before the next TV station would hit the LA airwaves. It was a great moment of pride for Landsberg, a moment that for many might have been the crowning event of a long lifetime. But at the time, Klaus was just 29 years old. Klaus's ex-wife, Evie, wrote about that first program in letters to her family living in Brazil.
From the viewer's point of view, it was swell. But from the reviewer's point of view, a critical cutthroat bunch, it wasn't as professional as it should have been. Klaus, of course, took the blame, and it was very unfair. He was quite unhappy about it. But every slap is a boost, and he's even more determined to show them a few things. So many people haven't yet faith in television. I guess those are the things that we, the pioneers, have to go through. It's a grand challenge, however.
A couple of bad reviews couldn't slow down Klaus for a minute, and KTLA was off and running and growing, just like the city itself. In a moment, we'll relive more of those moments that a lot of our viewers still remember. But before our present-day commercials, here's a look at KTLA's first commercial back in 1947.
Another button operates the windows. Inside, fabrics are rich and colorful. Fittings are smartly styled. Under the hood, a new and finer Lincoln engine is ready to challenge traffic and the open road.
KTLA's 50 Golden Years is brought to you in part by Sun Microsystems. The network is the computer.
KTLA was off and running all right, but at first that growth would be pretty limited. The law in LA said that no building could be taller than the city hall. As you'll see, this put a somewhat dampening effect on the famous opening of Jack Webb's classic series Dragnet, which KTLA viewers would later see in syndication as badge 714.
This is the city. 450 square miles of it. 150,000 acres. A big place. 6,000 miles of streets. 2 million people. In my job, you get a chance to meet them all. I'm a cop. This is the city hall. The base is 476 feet on its longitudinal axis. The tower goes up 452 feet above the level of Main Street. They put it up to stay. Limestone from France, marble from Tennessee, gray California granite. It was Tuesday, November 15th. It was cold in Los Angeles. We'd been working the early watch out of Central Division, Detective Bureau. I got an emergency call to check back in at the office. An entire block in the heart of the city was facing sudden total destruction. We had 26 minutes to try and stop it. This is the story of those 26 minutes.
Growing up right along with KTLA was our birthday buddy Constance Craig, born the same day as the station, but at first, watching TV wasn't too easy for her.
It was my bedtime, so I'd be sent off to bed, but then when the adults weren't looking, I'd sneak back in, climb under one of the chairs, and keep watching television until I got caught one time.
From underneath that chair, Constance watched her favorite shows, and they read like a rundown of an early KTLA program log.
She spayed Cooley, Harry Owens and his Royal Hawaiians, Ina Ray Hutton and her all-girl band.
This clip is from 1951. It has not been seen in 46 years.
The Ina Ray Hutton all-girl show starring Ina Ray Hutton.
And good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Well, here we are, back again with a brand new show for you, which we really and truly hope that you'll enjoy this week. First of all, we'd like to say that we still have all girls and no men allowed.
The charms of Ina Ray Hutton and her all-girl band were a big favorite with KTLA viewers. Live musical programs were a hit from the very beginning, starting in 1948 with
The Spade Cooley Show, starring Manfred and Brandon Yours, Spade Cooley.
Welcome to the Santa Monica Ballroom. Well, we've got a fine show lined up for you tonight, and we'd like to open the program with a tune that features the very fine steel guitar playing of one Noel Boggs. So here is that steel guitar rag. Oh, ladies and gentlemen.
Where's Noel?
He didn't come back from his dancing lesson yet.
He didn't come back from his dancing lesson. No.
The Spade Cooley Show, which ran 10 years, was part variety, part country music, part comedy, and all successful. The success of the Cooley Show touched off a wave of musical variety programs on KTLA. From the Aragon Ballroom in Ocean Park, Harry Owens and his Royal Hawaiians began on KTLA in 1949, and the show was an immediate hit. Featuring Hilo Hattie singing favorites like Sweet Leilani, Owens played what he called music from the islands south of paradise. Within a year, the show was voted the most popular television program in Los Angeles.
Before we now
shows seemed to run, both on camera and behind the scenes, it was actually a time of trial and error, and sometimes a time of just plain panic. Cliffy Stone, host of Hometown Jamboree, remembered just how shaky it all really was.
Come on back here.
That we served a purpose. We got up there when we were all idiots, had no knowledge of what we were doing, and did our thing like monkeys in a cage. We said, look at me, watch me, you know? And a lot of time it was awful, I'm sure. I have looked at a kinescope, I only have one, and it is so bad, I can't believe the show was ever on. They learned about cameras on us, and they learned about lights, and they learned about sound, and they learned about production. And we were fortunate to have been on the scene at the time that that red light came on. Very fortunate.
How about you folks, you had a good time, huh? Why don't you all come out to Hometown Jamboree, huh?
Despite all that off-camera madness, no one in those early days seemed more at ease and relaxed than a turbaned, inscrutable organ player named Corla Pandit. Viewer William Arnold told us of his mother's fascination.
I came in the house one day, and the TV wasn't in the window. And I said, Mom, she said, shh. And I looked, and she was enraptured by this guy who was a really beautiful man, not just physically handsome. His features were beyond it. He was just purely beautiful. I wasn't even sure it was a man or woman at the time.
And viewer Margaret Johnson was even more mesmerized.
He didn't speak, he didn't smile, he didn't frown. He just sat there and the camera stayed on his face so that you watched him while he played the organ. So you hear him.
A cloud, misty cloud, and that kept the transition from the show to the commercials, but kept it in a thread going through as you would in a concert. That was my original concept. And of course, once it started that way, everyone said, well, can he talk? And they said, then Claude said, never talk. And it went on. And then each, of course, day or each year got a bit more mysterious, and so they never would let me talk. And 900 live shows, we never spoke.
At the other extreme from the brooding, silent Pandit, but as popular, was the joyous production called Frosty Frolics, done entirely on ice skates. Viewers Ruth and Jim Farrell remember it well.
Group of people got together, there was singing, there was dancing, little skits and whatnot. It was just kind of a family thing on ice. Very enjoyable.
It's Frosty Frolics, your musical comedy on ice.
Wanted, opportunity for young man. Mediocre appearance will do. No salary, but free tourist class accommodations for France. Oh, boy, it's a real chance. Paris, here I come.
Klaus Landsberg knew that before he could even bring flickering black and white images to the handful of TV sets in Los Angeles, he had to find just the right location to place his transmitter.
He searched high and low, well, high anyway, for the perfect spot, a place where the signal from a transmitter could beam into the greatest part of the Southland.
Finally, he decided upon Mount Wilson, and like Columbus planting his banner on the New World, or Neil Armstrong planting the flag on the moon, Klaus struck a marker into the mountaintop and pronounced that this was the place. Klaus was so proud of his decision that he couldn't wait to share it with his wife, Evie.
Klaus put me in a bucket, little bucket, and I entered a little bucket up on Mount Wilson, and Ray Moore pulled the little bucket up with Klaus and me in this big bucket. And he said, Evie, I'm going to show you why we're so great. And he took up on the bucket to show where the top of the antenna was going to be. And he said, now, it's all vision. It's all straight vision. As far as the eye can see, you will have television.
In those years that followed, all those live remotes that Klaus would beam up from his chosen mountaintop would be just a rehearsal for the main event, the moment when we would cover a real breaking news story. It came on February 21st, 1947, just days after the station signed on as KTLA. A terrible explosion rocked a factory in East Los Angeles, killing 15 people and injuring hundreds more. Within minutes, KTLA's cameras were on the scene, sending out live pictures. For the LA Times, the explosion was page one news, but for the first time, a newspaper was scooped by TV on a major news story. And the way news would be covered would never be the same again. If a new form of journalism would arise from the ashes of an East LA factory, it would secure its position on what was a vacant lot in San Marino.
The event that really established television as a news medium occurred right here on what is now the athletic field of San Marino High School. On April 9th, 1949, this was a vacant lot. And right about here was an abandoned water well that reached 230 feet down into the ground. 3.5-year-old Kathy Fiscus lived nearby, and on that fateful day, she went playing in the lot. Somehow she tumbled into the well. So we started in, and having no idea that we'd be here any length of time. It was, let's see what's going on. The thing that is so incredible looking back now, we had no idea of the impact that this was going to make. I can remember sitting in the front of a pickup truck, kind of cold, maybe 2 a.m. with a microphone on my lap and thinking, who in the world would be watching this? It really brought the city together. Los Angeles was a big city, but on this one weekend it became a small town city. Neighbors would visit neighbors that they didn't know very well. They'd sit in front of the set. They'd have dinner there. They'd go to sleep on the floor. Really right up to the end, well, till an hour or two before the end, we really thought that she was going to be saved. And all of a sudden, the word was that she was dead. And everybody broke into tears. Everybody was quiet. People walked away to be by themselves. And it was a very emotional thing. And I think that's the impact that people watching had. That for the first time, they experienced the long form of television, that they were a part of this whole broadcast from the moment they started looking. And having spent that much time and that much emotion and that much energy to find out that she was dead, the whole city really suffered a personal loss.
And as my colleague at the scene, Bill Welch, was to learn, the coverage also had a profound effect on the grieving parents of the dead child.
Gene Biscolers, then the sheriff of Los Angeles County, had brought in a lot of his deputies to help the San Marino police handle the crowds that were gathering. And he came to me and he says, you know, the Fiscus family was watching this on television until it got so sad that they turned it off and they don't know what's happened. And he says, they know you, Bill, so would you be willing now to go up to their home and tell them that the little girl is dead? And I said to Gene, I said, who was my friend, I said, of course, I will do it. So after the 27 and a half hours of television, I went to the, called the Fiscus family together and told them that Kathy was just not coming home.
As extraordinary as the coverage of the Kathy Fiscus tragedy was, Klaus Landsberg always believed that his major news accomplishment was setting up the first live TV broadcast of an atomic bomb blast. On April 22, 1952, the Atomic Energy Commission scheduled the test explosion of an A-bomb on the Nevada desert. And just 18 days before, it announced it would allow live TV coverage. The telephone company said it could easily set up phone lines to carry the picture. It would only take 6 months. It was an impossible task to accomplish in less than 3 weeks. But Klaus and the KTLA engineering team did it. With the help of helicopters that Klaus persuaded the Marines to lend, equipment was flown from peak to peak. The biggest problem was finding what Klaus called Mount X, the final mountaintop that allowed pictures to reach Los Angeles. Finally, Mount X was located, the equipment installed, and a live picture reached Los Angeles just 1 hour before the blast. When it happened, every Los Angeles TV station and all three networks carried KTLA's picture live coast to coast. KTLA engineer John Polish remembers.
We knew the plane was in the air for about 10 minutes, and they said they're going to give us a countdown from 10 minutes to 5 minutes, and then the last 10 seconds they're going to count down 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, all the way down to the explosion. And we're looking up into the sky, we're trying to see, and they said, don't look at this bomb with the naked eye, because it'll burn your eyes out, because it's a white, white flash. So everybody had lenses and glasses, dark glasses, you couldn't see anything, hardly. And I didn't want to wear glasses, because I wanted to see what it looked like, so I turned my back to the, because the bomb was going to be behind me, so I turned my back to the bomb, and you could feel as the guy was counting this down, 10, 9, 8, and I said, oh, I hope it goes in the right place.
5, 4, 3, 2, 33, 1, 0. Well, there it is. The first public demonstration and the biggest continental atomic detonation in the history of the world. That, of course, was the shock wave. And looking into the cloud, you see the orange, the brown, the dirty black, and the fringed white. Beautiful, tremendous, and angry spectacle on this waste and barren desert.
10 days later, a second blast was scheduled, and with equipment still in place, KTLA again carries it live. News director Gil Martin described the event.
18, 19, 20. There it is, that brilliant flash, that white light that precedes the explosion of the atomic bomb number 17. 40 miles away, a brilliant white flash, almost blinding with those rocket trails coming out of it. The fire is dying now. It's turning to a dull red, not quite the brilliant orange and purple and green of past atomic bombs, but a beautiful sight. The typical funnel shape rising into that giant mushroom cloud and now blossoming out like a big ball of cotton.
Look, Joe, I think it might interest our audience, which is watching this telecast in Los Angeles, that perfect reception was enjoyed of this atomic explosion all through the country. We had a report from the telephone company that fed the picture from Los Angeles to where we brought it all the way across the country. That reception was perfect all the way through, and we're delighted about it, of course.
Setting up that microwave link from the sweltering desert floor to the freezing mountains was backbreaking work. It was especially hard on Klaus. Sometime before, he had been diagnosed with lung cancer and had recently undergone several operations.
Well, he'd been sick off and on and had been to the hospital, but I never thought that anything could finish him off or do anything. I knew he was sick, and he'd been through several operations, but to me, he seemed indestructible. I remember going to Knott's Berry Farm and taken there by somebody else, and he was brought in an ambulance to direct the show, which was City at Night. And he came in the ambulance and directed the show and, you know, visited with me a little bit, and then the ambulance took him back to the hospital. That was just the way he did things.
Even though his health continues to fail, Klaus began working on another development that would change forever the way that news is covered. Live pictures beamed from a helicopter. As common as that is today, it was unheard of in the early 1950s. Working with KTLA's chief engineer John Silva, Klaus tackled the almost overwhelming technical problems the project would encounter. By 1956, they were halfway there, but Klaus Landsberg would never see a live picture from the air. He died on September 16, 1956. Despite his awesome achievements, he was only 40 years old.
In my area of this business that is television, news, Klaus Landsberg's great genius was that without any formal training, He had a great new sense to combine with his fantastic technical ability. He was one of the first advocates of live television, getting the live camera out where the action was. He lives in all of our hearts for his pioneering efforts in this particular regard.
But the work would go on. In 1958, from an aircraft called the Telecopter, the first pictures were transmitted.
There is a beautiful live shot right now. The telecopter is over the Memorial Coliseum. There are the instructions for the telecopter to proceed to land. And it will now circle again and come in this large cement area. A beautiful shot from that picture. The first live telecast from a helicopter, a truly history-making event. Now, we are shooting it from our camera on the ground in a circle over the tall trees. We'll come in during that particular area there. It's coming in very slowly now. We'll hit just about this spot in the middle of the cement area. You hear the loud roar of the props. The skids are there, a big blast of wind hits us there, and the helicopter has made its rendezvous here at the Coliseum.
For the next 10 years, no other TV station in America and no other station in the world would have anything like it. And KTLA viewers could see the news from an entirely innovative perspective.
He is presently taxiing about 30 miles an hour. There are some 8 police cars and about 4 or 5 motorcycle officers assisting in redirecting traffic around this airplane. They've now released some of the traffic behind the airplane, and the traffic is pacing the aircraft. They both have a hand on him. And he's dropped to his knees, and they're dragging him to the window on his left. It looks like they've got him in tow now. He's trying. Yes, the fireman with the safety belt just went in the window, and they're dragging him in.
And to help put all the news into perspective, an entire corps of distinguished news reporters would join KTLA beginning in the 1960s. Cleet Roberts.
That's the news, ladies and gentlemen.
Bill Stout.
Exactly what the governor will put.
Tom Snyder.
Birthday, it's number 100.
Bob Arthur. Joseph Benty,
for some young people.
George Putnam,
Bob,
Terry Drinkwater, Hugh Brundage, and Hal Fisher. And over the years, even this group of outstanding reporters would be tested to the utmost, as KTLA would lead the way in covering an almost unbelievable procession of hammer blow assaults by nature and by man on the Los Angeles area. November 1960, the young KTLA telecopter would be put to its first major test of fire, literally, as the hills of Bel Air erupted into a full-scale inferno. Cleet Roberts and Bill Stout covered the blaze from remote units on the ground.
All right, we're going to move our camera back and get it out of the way. We're in that embarrassing position of being in the way before the firemen are. All right, we're going to put this fire out. It makes us happy. We've been trying to put it out ourselves. He says there's no use fooling with this. They don't have enough water.
The fire would blaze for 2 days, destroying 456 homes. KTLA would provide live coverage for nearly 19 hours. By 1994, the telecopter would become SkyCam 5, and the pictures would be steady and in full color, and KTLA's coverage would continue to be just as comprehensive, as an even bigger blaze cut a path all the way from Pasadena to Malibu.
Evacuate now. You're in immediate danger. This is the Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department. We recommend all people in this area evacuate now.
But again, these flames are very close. They're encroaching upon this plateau of the hill, which houses about 6 other homes apart from this one. And again, with the gusts of wind traveling at perhaps 60, 70 miles per hour on the surface, you can imagine that those flames are going to be really traveling fast up that hillside towards that home, as we've been watching over the past just few minutes.
There on the right-hand side of the screen, there toward the bottom, you can see some of the firefighters that are still there near the edge of that hill. Apparently the others that you saw, now you can see that it looks like they're picking up their hoses, waiting for it to get a little bit closer.
The shot you're seeing is a smoke, and of course it's gotten a lot closer to us than it was about an hour ago. What you're also seeing is evacuation in full flight along Pacific Coast Highway.
We also see it coming in the other direction. If you look back that way, there's fire in that direction as well. So really we're surrounded on three sides by flames here. It just, it was lazily coming up the canyon for the longest time. Now it's not being so lazy anymore.
When we come back, some Southern California news events that will never be forgotten.
When they catch fire.
Famous people to events that shaped our lives. Join Hal Fishman and Stan Chambers for a KTLA News special. Whatever Happened To, tonight at 10 on the WB5.
These days at KTLA, favorite entertainment programs include Xena, Hercules, and among the most popular, Seinfeld.
Yeah!
Guy!
Come in!
Where can I put this?
What is it?
It's Risk, Jerry. The game of world conquest. All right, that's perfect.
Kramer, why do you have to... Hello, Newman.
But back in 1948, one of the first and most popular entertainment shows was Pantomime Quiz, a show inspired by the old living room game charades.
And it's a song for Adele Jurgens to act out. Every little movement has a meaning all its own.
You're on. This is one of the cubes. Let's see what you do with it.
Go ahead. Oh, yes, I like this.
It's a song.
Little. Do that other thing again, will you?
Every little movement has a meaning.
KTLA was barely on the air when a young kid named Mike Stokey brought the idea to Klaus Landsberg. By 1949, the show would join Shirley Dinsdale as an Emmy winner in that very first year that awards were presented. And her salary was increased to make her the highest paid TV personality in Los Angeles. She was now getting $250 a week.
They told me I had to go to this banquet at the Hollywood Athletic Club that night after my show. I didn't want to go. I had a date. And I really didn't know what this was all about. They said it was for the Academy. It meant nothing to me. It was the first one.
She got the award. It shouldn't have been.
Well, it said to Shirley Dinsdale, and Judy has always felt very badly about that.
I thought it was for me. I mean, I'm the one that had the personality. She learned to talk later.
Before long, KTLA was providing entertainment and information for its viewers from dawn to midnight and beyond. For early risers, the venerable Jack LaLanne was fighting flab and featuring fitness long before calorie counting became fashionable.
Happy Monday morning. Hey, they're all my little boys and girls, my helpers. Boys and girls, come here. Did you have a nice weekend? Did you have fun this weekend?
You know, when I first started, like in 1936, when I started my first health spa, the doctors were against me, all the coaches. See, I was the first one in the world to have women working out with the weights. I was the first one in the world to get athletes working out with the weights. You know, this was the first, believe me. And everybody was against me. All the doctors, don't you go to that Jack LaLanne, you'll get muscle bound, you'll get hemorrhoids, you'll lose your sex drive. You women will look like men, you'll get hair in your chest, you'll lose your boobs. And you athletes, you won't even be able to throw football, you won't be able to lift your arms overhead. Now, the fastest growing sport in the world is weight training for women. And there's not one world-class athlete that's not into weight training. See, so from a charlatan, from a crackpot, doing the same thing, now I'm an authority.
Later in the morning, Chorus Guy was hosting one of the very first cooking shows.
What have we got here, Chorus?
Well, you know, Stan, I don't usually do any comparative testing of foods.
I know you don't.
Well, tonight I'd like to have you try, though, two different cups of coffee.
Well, that's fair enough. Is this something new, though? Mm-hmm.
This is marked A for your benefit.
A.
Uh-huh.
What do you want? Oh, I know. Now, let's see. You want me to tell which of the MJB?
Uh-huh, that's right.
Well?
I want to see if you can tell.
Mmm. That's good.
And in the early evening, Dorothy Gardner was dispensing handy hints with Dick Garten.
One of the things Klaus told me just before we were ready to go on, and he said, I want you to remember one thing. You are a guest in their home. When they turn the dial to Channel 5, they've invited you into their house and act accordingly. And I thought, I never forgot that.
Dorothy and Keith Hetherington were the hosts of KTLA's first public affairs show, City at Night. A new and exciting concept, City at Night would take viewers live to remote locations around Los Angeles, ranging from manufacturing plants to movie sets. Here in 1949, Keith and Dorothy were on the set of the movie Destination Moon.
This just gives you a little idea of what the cameraman...
One of our cameramen, they're having a little bit of trouble.
Well, as they put it here, it isn't exactly trouble, it's just plain hard work.
The camera work was a bit shaky, and the show was presented in beautiful black and white, but primitive as it was, its feeling of live TV, where anything could happen, kept viewers fascinated.
Oh, of course.
Here, 1950s City at Night host Ken Grau improvises when his microphone goes dead. Some two decades later, when the late Bill Stout hosted a revival of City at Night, it was a flawless production. This edition was a last look at the historic Bunker Hill area, which was soon to be demolished. In 1964, Paramount Pictures would sell KTLA to Gene Autry and his Golden West Broadcasting. Autry vowed to make KTLA's programming even better. And of course, that would include his own show, Melody Ranch.
Out where a friend is a friend.
After I bought the station, well, we completely changed the whole thing. They had a bunch of these shows on the air, game shows, a lot of them were, and they would give away old dishes and everything else, you know, for the winners. And it got to be in such a mess that we had to get rid of all that junk. So we got rid of all of that, and we started then buying films.
One of KTLA's successful acquisitions was the syndicated version of one of America's most popular programs, The Adventures of Ozzie and Harriet. Ozzie and Harriet Nelson lived with their boys, Ricky and David, in a make-believe world that is still the prototype for a mid-century, mid-income, middle America that never really existed. Or did it? Perhaps it did for David Nelson, who was 16 when the series began.
Well, 5 years ago, I looked in the mirror in the morning and I thought, oh my, boy, you're getting old. All these wrinkles are starting to get real deep, and I'm a little depressed, and I went down to the local coffee shop to get a cup of coffee. A couple kids came up and said, weren't you on the Nelson show? And I said, yes, I was. And he said, how's Dave and Rick?
In 1973, on KTLA's public affairs show, Paysetters, host Ray Gonzalez, presently KTLA's director of public affairs, conducted a rare interview, one of the very last, with Desi Arnaz.
What happened? I mean, after a while, you top show, you live together, you have children. What happened to Lucy and Desi? Why did they break up?
I don't know. I guess
is a very bad thing about this country. And I hate to say it because I love the United States of America. But you cannot be halfway successful here. Either you get real big, 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 or they swallow you up. And we had to get so big that I hated it.
You were president of two divisions.
I just hated it. I didn't want any part of it. And it's a sad thing to say, but I'd like to see the corner drugstore come back. And Joe owns the market in the little town come back.
So that's...
It was just too much. I was competing with the big fellows. And if I didn't get as big as they were, they would swallow me up. And I didn't want to get that big. It wasn't fun getting that big.
We'll be right back with more, but first here's a vintage commercial the announcer might wish to forget.
Hi, I'm Mike Wallace with a sensational shortening discovery for better baking and frying. It's Procter & Gamble's Golden Fluffle, the first all-new shortening in 40 years. It's rich. Its color is golden yellow. And what a pie it makes. Richer looking, better tasting, more appetizing. But let's hear what Mrs. Thelma Styra, Indiana State Fair baking champion, had to say about Fluffo.
I love Fluffo. It makes such a golden brown pie.
Oh, man, that's some apple pie.
Well, Mr. Wallace, that's a prettier pie than I ever baked with plain white shortening. And look how flaky it is. This yellow Fluffo is such a short shortening. Makes pie crust so rich.
Like cooking champions, get richer looking, better tasting, more appetizing results in everything you bake or fry. Get Golden Fluffo.
Any of you guys know how to work these buttons? Oh, Sam Rubin here. We're back at the KTLA studios. Remember those days when you popped Jiffy Pop, watched cars explode into flame at the Destruction Derby? Well, we're about to relive them all, along with Roller Derby, my personal favorite, Bowling for Dollars, wrestling as well. All that, plus stay tuned for Dodger phenomenon Hideo Nomo's first no-hitter and David Letterman's first Los Angeles television appearance. All of it is coming up next on KTLA's 50 Golden Years.
KTLA's coverage of sports goes back to the days when the station was still W6XYZ. As soon as the station became KTLA, Klaus knew that sports was the important key to the station's success. And he couldn't wait to get his cameras out to old Gilmore Field to cover the Hollywood stars. Or send Dick Lane out to cover something like Destruction Derby.
That's Howard Walton driving a 48 class with that black car. Up by the wall, the car's on fire directly before us here. Right in front of the grandstand, get those drivers out of there. As quickly as you can, unhook those drivers, get them out of there. These two cars are on fire. One of them, Mark Tijuana Police, is coming out head first. Get the extinguishers out, the fire crew is here. Look out for an explosion. Stay away from those cars. Our camera's within 10 feet of these cars.
Or the ever-popular roller derby, which ran on KTLA for three decades.
Quinn going to try one more time. He missed it. He took him completely out of the world. They got a panel set for him. He says, come on, now, now. He hurdles using Danny Riley's back. 7 T-Bird points, and look at him going to work on the leg again. Oh, come on. Hey, he got in there, too. That's a dummy. Big Earlene is emptying this building.
Out here means that. And of course, wrestling, which Dick Lane called on KTLA from the 1940s to the 1970s.
Tough match for both of them. They both know they've been in there. And
set for the neck breaker. He tags Leo. Leo comes in and throws the left hook in the middle and takes the front headlock. A Beal and sends the Baron rolling. Another Beal by Leo. Bombs away. There he goes, and the Baron goes outside. Here comes George and takes one to the jaw. Bombs for the George, and he's in the corner staggering.
Bill hurries in and bombs the Baron again and sends it out over the top rope. Oh, Nelly.
Some people may have called these junk sports, but consider this. In 1950, wrestling on KTLA was awarded an Emmy as the best sports program on television. In 1964, Dick Enberg became the voice of KTLA Sports.
My very first week at KTLA, I did the sports on the news. Hugh Brundage was the anchorman, and Hal Fishman was the new reporter on the scene. We stood behind separate podiums, and I can remember in my nervousness, I had all my copy in my hand to read the sports show, and just as Hugh Brundage said, and now with, I dropped all of my copy, and he continued as I went over to pick my copy up, with sports, here's Dick Enberg, and I just popped up merrily and went on with the show.
And Chick Hearn, the voice of the Lakers, would also become a long-running sportscaster on KTLA. Chick broadcast the unlikely for him sport of bowling.
Said if she won some money here, she'd go to Vegas. Margaret, with the money you won with that ball, you ain't going even to Pomona.
I didn't have a feel for it. Walked through it and so forth, and I thought, I don't think it'll go. I thought it might go 13 weeks, but I wasn't interested in that. So I turned it down. And very, very suddenly and very shortly thereafter, my son died tragically. And I was at a loss. Terrible loss. And I said to my wife, what can I do until the next basketball season comes around? I've got to get busy. So I called Heck Heighton and explained it to him. He said, they haven't cast anybody in the job yet. Come on back down. They liked you. So, and to make a long story short, that's how I got into bowling for dollars. I went for, as I say, not 13 weeks, but many, many years.
Today, Vin Scully and the LA Dodgers are the jewels in KTLA Sports Ground. Scully himself is a member of baseball's Hall of Fame.
Hi, everybody, and a very pleasant good evening to you, wherever you may be. Not so pleasant.
Perhaps the number one memory in our association with KTLA would be that rainy night in Denver.
No pageantry associated with sports can equal the Rose Parade. And in 1947, when the station was still W6XYZ, Klaus brought his live cameras out to Pasadena to provide coverage. And in the ensuing half century, KTLA's cameras have been there ever since. In January of this year, longtime Rose Parade host Stephanie Edwards and Bob Eubanks described one of the parade's most spectacular moments.
The stealth bomber. There it is. Look at this. Look at this. It's a long ways away right now.
But it's exactly on time.
And supposed to arrive at 8:05. It's going to fly, like we said, 1,000 feet above the ground. It'll be flying between 200 and 258 knots, which is as slow as it can fly.
Lost on the audience, really, right? Because they don't know it's coming.
Yeah.
We can just begin to see it in the west. It's really a shadow. It's a flat shadow coming through the air. I am excited by this.
This gives me goosebumps.
It's like a little flat wedge coming in.
Isn't that amazing? And it's going to fly 1,000 feet.
Can't hear a thing, can you, Bob?
No.
Oh, my gosh.
Look at that. Look at that.
He's doing maneuvers. Now, there's a tower there that really is rather
high. One of our KTLA cameras right there.
They seem to know exactly what
they're
doing.
Look at this.
I certainly hope they do, because they're ever so close to us.
The excitement in the audience is just incredible.
Oh, they do spot it. Yeah, everybody has spotted it now. All faces are turned in that direction. My gosh, it looks like it's coming right at us.
Look at this. I'm curious about the horses that are down on the Orange Grove. Look at this.
So quiet.
Oh. Celebrating the 50th anniversary of the United States Air Force.
In 1979, David Letterman made one of his earliest TV appearances when he took part in KTLA's pre-parade coverage.
We'll be looking at the parade as it forms on Orange Grove, and then it goes on up and eventually makes a right-hand turn onto Colorado. Last year, of course, some of the floats made a left-hand turn, ended up in Needles. What is your name, sir?
Star.
Gentleman's name is Star. And what have you been doing for the last 24 hours?
Hiding and raiding girls.
Raiding girls. The horse smells like beer. It's an interesting phenomenon. Do you have any problem with them out here in the cold air?
No, they adore a parade.
Oh, and I adore horses. How about a big wet kiss from a horse?
Hey, Dave.
And not on your life. Yes, sir.
Usual used to have on the end of his bat one of those horseshoes.
Sports humor. I can't get enough of it.
Another parade that's become a tradition on KTLA is the annual Hollywood Christmas Parade, produced by KTLA's very own honorary mayor of Hollywood, Johnny Grant.
Well, I think the best wish is that be good to each other and don't judge each other. We've all got our problems.
Perhaps the most dramatic parade televised by KTLA came in 1991, marking the end of Operation Desert Storm. Produced by Johnny Grant and hosted by Lisa Gibbons and Bob Eubanks. Thousands of Desert Storm veterans marched along Sunset Boulevard, accompanied by an imposing display of military equipment and dozens of bands. The parade also saluted the veterans of World Wars I and II, Korea, and Vietnam.
Vietnam women veterans marching by now.
There's such an interesting energy that's going on right now.
It's just like a wave that has been building and building.
And you can feel it.
There's almost a real cathartic element to this parade marching by and the audience getting a chance to say thanks.
I mean, we're so grateful to the Desert Storm and to have the troops back and such. And I think this is the first time that certainly Southern California has said thank you to the Vietnam men and women. And boy, are the emotions rolling on Sunset Boulevard right now.
Whatever else it has done in the past half century, nothing has shaped the character and reputation of KTLA as much as its coverage of the news. And as we'll see when we return, KTLA's news coverage began almost as soon as the station went on the air.
Man under Manny Strand, we had built a Alpine hotel, and it was right there on the ice. In fact, we used to get phone calls at the station from people saying, can we make reservation to the Alpine Hotel for the show next week?
Your Majesty, may I present it?
I was the only performer on the show who couldn't skate. So what we would do at the end of the broadcast, I would always somehow get out toward the middle and do something, and I would fall. And then the skaters, the fraulettes, they were, I guess they were either half a dozen or a dozen of the chorus girls, you might say. They would come out, make a big circle and dance around me as I was there on the wet ice. And I think I fell down in every Frosty Frolic show for several years.
Another musical treasure of those early KTLA days was Bandstand Review, with the music of Frank Duvall, the singing of Harry Babbitt, and host Leighton Noble.
We have a show today you can't be missing. KTLA Bandstand Review with Leighton Noble to welcome all of you. Sunshine.
Sometimes we did as many as 30 tunes in an hour, if you can imagine that. That leaves 2 minutes for a song. And sometimes they were only a chorus. But we did that. The top 10 or top 20 tunes and so on.
Trousers and motorcycle boots and a black leather jacket with an eagle on the back.
Nearly all of those shows were Klaus Landsberg's live remotes, and nearly all of them came from the Aragon Ballroom on Lick Pier near Santa Monica. Many of those great performers are gone now, and so was Lick Pier itself, a victim of fire and of progress. Nothing from the Aragon Ballroom was as thrilling to viewers as the music from a young accordion player who started his career as a KTLA late night time filler. Almost immediately, Landsberg knew he'd found a winner. Within a year, he moved the Welk Show to the prime slot on Friday nights, One of the most popular personalities to emerge from the Welk Show was Champagne Lady Roberta Lynn.
If you're going to do an impersonation of Lawrence Welk, every B is a P. Or it was in those days. My name was Roberta, and it was the poison to pent. And because of this, he would say things that came out a little different. And here's how he introduced one of the shows. I think it was our first television show. He said, "Good evening, my friends, and welcome to our very first TV show. Here from the beautiful Aragon Ballroom. Tonight, we got the Champagne Lady, Roberta Lynn, and all the boys in the pent, and we got the new arrangement in the key of G. Okay, boys, I want you all to pee on your toes now. A one and a two, and a tick away."
Well, let me ask you something. Did you ever lead an orchestra before?
No.
This is the first time, huh?
I'm very green at it.
Well, you want to try it? Take a try at it?
Try anything you want.
Fine. Boys, put up the Bye Bye Blues. Bye Bye Blue, that's a very easy song.
Bye, oh, I hope so.
Bye Blue. Okay, you come over here and give the boys a little downbeat, John. He's like this here. Okay. That's the idea. Okay, take it over. Okay.
Other evenings, KTLA viewers were entertained by the ever-present Dick Lane, this time as the ship's captain on a musical extravaganza called Dixie Showboat. Here's a recently discovered clip from 1950 with cast regular Scatman Carruthers.
I tell you so you can understand. Folks, I'm the Scatman.
In 1949, photographer Coy Watson and reporter Erskine Johnson put Hollywood Reel on TV. It was the first show devoted to Hollywood entertainment news.
Yes, it's Roddy McDowell and starlet Susan Morrow. Roddy knows his way around the country mark, but Susan is all eyes.
One of Hollywood's greatest comedians, Stan Laurel. As usual, Stan is confused. How did I get myself into this?
Anyone for tennis? When you say that in Hollywood, you might draw Robert Stack as your partner. And that means fast play because Bob Stack is an athletic whiz kid.
Steve Allen's syndicated late night show aired on KTLA.
And the only other ingredient required is the tea bags. And here they are.
It's iced tea. Now they put the ice cubes in. Here goes the sugar. Here goes the lemon. Just a little twist of lemon.
Gentlemen, tea is served. Soupy Sales had a comedy series on KTLA.
That proves that X equals zero.
Real.
That's the answer, zero?
Real.
Well, no wonder you don't like algebra.
Real.
Why?
Real.
All that work for nothing.
Oh! Real.
The words of wisdom for tomorrow is never buy a TV set from a man on the street who's out of breath.
Show me a man who keeps both feet on the ground, and I'll show you a man who can't get his pants off.
We'll be right back with some of your favorite KTLA kid shows, but first, a classic 1950s commercial.
Listen, hear that? Band music. Come on over and watch the parade with me. It's Oldsmobile on parade. New 98s, Super 88s, and 88s. The most popular Oldsmobiles ever built.
the great rocket engine cars that are setting new sales records month after month. And here in this brilliant parade is an Oldsmobile designed especially for you. So visit your Oldsmobile dealer soon. Try the new Rocket 8 and see why more people than ever are getting out of the ordinary and into an Olds.
From the letters and calls from our viewers, it seems pretty clear that part of the fun of growing up in L.A. was growing up with KTLA. It certainly was for William Arnold and his friends.
After we got to playing baseball every night, we'd run home and watch the movie. We'd watch KTLA and Time for Beanie and all that good stuff.
Time for Beanie, a daily 15-minute live broadcast created by the late Bob Clampett, featuring the voices and puppeteering of Stan Freberg and the late Dawes Butler.
Man, I wouldn't even like that if it was good.
Hi, Cecil.
Hi.
How you doing, boy?
Oh, pretty good.
How you feel today after you know that dynamite yesterday?
Well, huh? I'm back to my old subnormal self again.
I mean?
The next time I eat dynamite, I ain't gonna do it.
Every time I hear about demographics, you know, these yuppie marketing experts talk about the demographics and this piece of the market, that I think about, you know, would it be possible if somebody could create a show that would appeal to not only the children and the adults at the same time, but also Dr. Albert Einstein? Yes, it is possible, because we did that. We got a letter one day from a nuclear physicist at Caltech who told us that Dr. Einstein had been given an apartment by Caltech. He was helping with the jet propulsion lab at that point, I think. And he said he was in a high-level meeting of nuclear physicists, and Dr. Einstein kept looking at his pocket watch. All of a sudden, he stood up and said, "Gentlemen, you will have to excuse me. It's time for Beanie," and walked out of the room.
One time, you see, we'd have a character going off, and then we had a guy over there to do it. And so I said, maybe it was Beanie. So I said, "Well, I gotta go now. I'll see you later." And another thing he did, too, was that they would creep up. So we would pull him down so he wouldn't see my arm. And so I walked away. "I'll see you later, Cease." And I walked over, and instead of taking it off and putting on another one, he pulled it down so it was on tight. And I walked back in again. "I thought you were leaving."
"I was."
"Why didn't you?"
"Well, I thought of something."
"What was it?"
"I forget. I'll see ya."
And I walk out and look at him. You know, so I put it down. He goes, so I walk back in again. You know, finally, I walk out and I said, "This time I'm really going." He said, "Well, thank goodness, because it's going to be a long show." And I walk off, and he was walking over. I went, and the whole puppet just goes off like that.
Bob Clampett's widow, Zodi Clampett, remembers the start of Beanie on KTLA.
Bob got Claus Landsberg to come over and see Beanie in his little theater that he had in the garage. And it was a makeshift kind of thing. And so he came over, Claus did, and he sat there and he watched it. And at the end he said, "Let's go out for coffee." And so Bob wasn't too excited because he didn't seem to see much reaction from him. But they went out for coffee, and this was Friday that they had the showing. And he said, "Can you go on the air Monday night?"
"You want to apply for a Secret Service job?"
"Well, I don't know. I saw the sign on the tree."
"Okay, what's your name and how old are you?"
"My name is Cecil the C6C Serpent, and I'm 300 years old."
"Don't try to be funny, Jocko. Just answer the questions."
"Hmm?"
"How tall are you?"
See.
How tall?
35 feet 3 inches in my underwear."
"In your underwear, eh?"
"Yeah."
Well. Now just shut your trap and follow me. Now we're going to test your eyes. Come over here and read the bottom line."
"Oh, over there?"
"Over there."
Bottom line. "Yeah, the Acme Eye Chart Company."
A landmark children's show on KTLA was Sandy Dreams. It was the first TV program in the West that was produced with actors and a complete script. One of its fans was our viewer, Carol Levine.
"I loved Sandy Dreams because I thought these little girls were so adorable, particularly the little one. And the premise of the show was that this little girl would, who had this little rag doll, that she would fall asleep and her rag doll would come to life.
Sandy was played by Rosemary Iannone.
I was taking dance lessons at Rubens Dance School, and they had an audition, and everybody was eligible to try out. And probably 4 to 5 weeks later, I found out that I had gotten the part. I didn't know what TV was, because there was no TV.
Well, Stuffy, and how did you find your way up here?
For crying out loud, look, Sandy, could you just once say, Stuffy, how nice to see you?
Well, one time, Stuffy, he went off to go to the bathroom, right? And his part came on, and here we are, and we're ad-libbing like mad, and his mother's running around. Oh, was she mad at him?
Sandy, wake up! Sandy, look who we got!
I know. Ambrosia.
Amnesia, nothing!
Vance Colvig gained fame on KTLA as Bozo the Clown.
And I want to find out something here. Who would like prizes tonight, huh?
Skipper Frank Herman was an early favorite with his cartoon Carousel.
Good morning. Good morning.
So I went in and talked to Klaus on a Monday, and I said, what am I going to be? He says, I don't know. What do you want to be? And I said, you're still owned by Paramount? He said, yes. I said, can I go down to the wardrobe department and find something, and I'll call you? He said, okay. So at 3 o'clock, I'm down in the wardrobe going thing, and all I could find is things that will fit midgets. I couldn't find anything that will fit me at all. Finally, I found a blazer and a yachting cap. I get on the phone, because you never took Klaus for granted. It's about 20 minutes to 4, and I'm down at Paramount, and you know, I call him. I said, Mr. Landsberg, all I can find is a skipper hat and a blazer. What do you think of Skipper Frank? He says, that's lousy. I says, that's what you got.
I grew up in Southern California. Our family moved here in 1959 when I was 11 years old. And, of course, all kids back then loved to rush home after school and watch cartoons. And on KTLA, you had this golden run of talent, starting with Skipper Frank Herman, who was kind of a sea captain character that I partly based my character on the Pee Wee Herman show on, Captain Carl. And then it went to Tom Hatton's Popeye cartoon show. And I was an artist myself for many years, and maybe he was an influence on me, because he used to do a thing called squiggles, where he would sit at an easel with a big drawing pad, and he would have some kind of nondescript shape on it, and then he would quickly and facilely create some kind of image using that shape.
Pier 5 winners, KTLA, Hollywood 28. And we will ship a pair of Roller Derby Street King shoot skates to you just quicker than you can say, Jack Robinson. That'll do his best. Okay.
I was a staff announcer, and all I did was do off-camera announcements, the time of day, the stay tuned for, occasionally a commercial opening, and now Lou's Garage presents the family movie, whatever, and occasionally the big time stuff, the Spade Cooley show and Bandstand Review. But until I'd been here about 3 years, I didn't ever even appear on camera, because I was low man on the totem pole. There was Ken Grau, above him was Stan Chambers, above him was Keith Hetherington, and there was Tom Hatton down at the bottom, which would be glad to be there at 100 a week.
Miss Francis taught young people on KTLA's Ding Dong School.
Ding Dong School. What are you doing? Where? On the sofa? No? On a little chair? Comfortable? Well, good.
And in the 1960s, Shebang, produced at KTLA by Dick Clark and starring Casey Kasem.
I'll be right back with a look at the memorable moments of KTLA sports, news, and entertainment programs. But before leaving the kids' programs, here's a commercial you may remember.
I love Bosco. It's rich in chocolate tea. Chocolate-flavored Bosco is mighty good for me. Mama puts it in my milk for extra energy. Bosco gives me iron and sunshine vitamin D. Oh, I love Bosco. That's the drink for me.
Our special night of television continues with a very special guest, my KNX and KTLA colleague, Tom Hatton, the host of Family Film Festival, and of course, Popeye and Friends. Tom, good to see you.
Thank you. It's nice to cross the street and come down to my old haunt.
How often do people come up to you and say, oh, I remember?
I love it. They come up quite often, and since there were two different Popeye shows, one in the 60s and one in the 80s. I never am quite sure which people are watching which show, particularly women. You have to be very careful, because if some lady is 60 years old and you think she's... You know, anyway, quite often, and I love it.
How many Popeye episodes?
There were about 300 of the old good Paramount Fleischer ones, and of course my favorite was Goonland, when Popeye went back to Goon Island to rescue his father, Poop Deck Pappy.
And when they made the big screen Popeye, which we both know was not such a good idea.
Not so hot.
You had one of the stars with you.
I most certainly did. On our Sunday morning family film festival, we had Miss Shelley Duvall, who was absolutely wonderful. She was just getting ready to do the fairy tale stuff, which also were wonderful. But she was great. And that was about the greatest thing in the Popeye movie. I like Robin Williams, everybody does, but I didn't think that was working not too well.
Well, speaking of terrific stuff, coming up, we're going to head to the Melody Ranch for Gene Autry.
My boss.
Along with Mike Stokely's pantomime quiz.
No, and Stokely.
Stokely. No. Oh, and see, there, thank goodness Tom is here. And one of the last televised appearances of Desi Arnaz. Stay tuned for KTLA's 50 Golden Years next. Did you see this? Mike Wallace selling shortening?
CBS's Mike Wallace?
CBS's Mike Wallace.
Selling shortening.
On KTLA, no less. We'll be right back.